Thanks. There we are, having a nice, quiet moment to get the noise scape when I set up the noise reduction.
It was never gonna happen before.
And then you've just ruined it all, Matt. You've turned us into a crass Hollywood all ages film where there's a fart and a burp. Pinnacle of humor, according to troglodytes. Oh, that will have been picked up. Don't you worry.
Oh God,
it's going to be left here for eternity.
Or you could just get rid of it nicely in the first second.
No.
1 second cut. That's all it would take.
Look, I pride myself on my editing, and that one is a mark that shall forever remain against your name.
Goddamn.
This week, I decided not to explore wacky attempts at contextualizing films by viewing other films beforehand, and instead, I will apologize to Matt, because I suckered him into this project assuming that he knew more about the history of film and visual technique than he did. And of course, Matt is from more of a writing-based background. And so that was a bit of a cruel assumption on my part. So I figured, let's just look at some early instances of film, and because it's me, some early instances of animation. Really just here for fundamentals of constructing visuals. The way that we did this was we actually went backwards in time throughout the course of the evening. First, I showed a Warner Brothers short from 1942, then a feature-length Disney film from 1937, and finally, a live-action film from 1920. For next week will be Friday the 13th when we do our taping.
Oh, wow, really?
Yes. Ooh. That is why I want to do a film related to Friday the 13th. So yeah, my plan for next week will be back sort of on the context train. What I want to do is look at the slasher genre as farce and the slasher genre at its finest. So we'll be doing Jason X and Halloween.
But which is the worst and which is the finest?
I didn't say worst.
Oh, okay.
I said farce specifically.
Ah, okay. Fair enough.
Because if you want to watch a bad slasher movie, you just watch a Final Destination film.
Ah, that's fair.
Whoa, you can't escape death. The roller coaster's gonna kill you. Whoa.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of those movies either. So I'm happy we're not watching that.
In the meantime, history of film. And I wanted to, in particular, show you a bunch of early animation. And then we can talk about the textual value as much as we can. But all of my notes are related to technical facets of animation. So to begin with, we did a Warner Brothers short entitled A Tale of Two Kitties. It's the first Tweety Bird short, and that character isn't very well realized yet.
Well, it does have the iconic line. I thought I saw a putty tat, or
yes.
However he says it in his accent.
I tore a putty tat. I did not bring my pop filter, so that is going to sound awful in the recording. Apologies to everyone who just sat through that.
It's brave of you to do it.
Tale of Two Kitties, directed by Bob Clampett, by no means anywhere close to my favourite Warner Brothers short. But one of the animators who worked on it was Rob Scribner, who was one of the first animators to adopt the smear technique, which was created by an illustrator and cartoonist called George Lichty. It's sometimes known as things like Lichty animation or Lichty style. And basically, it's the motion blur effect that you see a bunch of times throughout the short where a hand will kind of look like it's stretched across, or that there's this additional layer of motion blur. Another good example would be if you're familiar with the mid-80s series Fist of the North Star, or Hokuto no Ken. The main character in that Mel Gibson lookalike, Kenshiro, has a move called the Hokuto Hyakuretsu Ken, the 100 crack fist blow, where he goes, WATER! And it looks like he's got about 50 fists flying across the screen at once, even though it's on every single frame. That's smearing.
Yeah, I know Fist of the North Star, and I know exactly what you're talking about, which is weird for me, but...
What you saw was the first example of that concept being applied to animation and motion. Because it's a trick that you use when drawing that he worked out for how to simulate rapid motion quickly. And it's very much a handy part of the toolbook for creating the illusion of motion when you're just using frames played in rapid sequence.
It sounds like a really important development, actually, because whenever I think of how animation has shown in either still images or in animation, it's one of the first things, or maybe the only thing, that comes to my mind. And I'm pretty sure we talked about smearing before, didn't we?
Probably. I am a big fan of goofy, overly stylized smears.
And I think we were upset in the Heavy Metal, I think it was Heavy Metal, where they refused to use smearing for that. I think it was the final
one. We'll be talking about Heavy Metal, because it breaks basically every rule that I might as well get onto. I mean, that's all I really wanted to say about A Tale of Two Kitties.
Sure.
If you have any comments that you'd like to add to it on any level.
Tweety Bird not being yellow is
disconcerting
to me. Yeah, I did not like that.
I like to think that it's because since he's in a nest and he doesn't fly at all, I assume that it's because he's a newborn chick and he hasn't quite gotten the correct colouring yet and he hasn't learned to fly. And
that's pretty good continuity then from Disney's on Disney's part.
Yeah, like, I'll say, especially since it's Warner Brothers.
Oh, right, I'm sorry.
It's okay. Everything comes back to Disney. I've managed to keep this show away from Disney for well over a month now, which I'm personally quite proud of, because no matter what we do, we will always be pulled back to the inexorable vortex that is Disney.
At least it's just one of the movies we watched was Disney, yes, instead of both.
No matter what you do, it will pull you back in, because this company is just too big and just way too significant to the media, both of film and animation. You will come to Disney. It's the great dichotomy that this big evil megacore unfortunately does actually let some good art get made within its walls.
Yeah, that was what I was thinking when you were saying that. Even though it mostly sounds like a bad thing, and it probably is, but you know, there obviously are good.
There's nuances.
Yeah, there is good in Disney.
You can feel it. You can sense it.
I don't think I can bring them back. I don't think anyone's going to be able to turn them into some kind of Jedi.
It's not bringing them back because it started off evil.
That's true. Yeah, I don't think they ever had a story like that with Jedi or Sith. Like someone who was just evil from the start.
It's just, hi there, I'm Walt Disney. Or is it like the phases of Disney can be charted by how much tar is in his lungs?
Yeah, get them cutting that.
I will say, as much as Saving Mr. Banks is a somewhat irksome film because of how it's Disney revisionist propaganda, I do like that they at least put one effort into acknowledging his tobacco addiction. By the very first appearance that Disney has is off screen with a very loud cough into a microphone. And it's not just like a light cough, it's a smoker's cough.
It's always good when a little bit of reality seeps through the facade of what Disney usually is.
Yes. So, we're making jokes about Disney, and that's fair enough, because what we watched was Snow White and the Seven Dwarves, 1937, first animated feature film, 83 minutes. It's 83 minutes long. The plot exists. It's not the first piece of animation. Obviously, there had been animated shorts before it. The first animated film in history is Winsor McCay's Little Nemo from 1911. Though it's very, very short and wonky, and more often what's considered in general cultural awareness as being the first piece of animation is also by Winsor McCay, and that's Gertie the Dinosaur. And basically, since this is the early 1910s, film was still very much a thing that weird parlor magicians and carnies would take with them as part of their act when traveling with circuses and the like, that you pay the money to go into a tent, and what he would do is he would say that he had a pet dinosaur with him that he's taught tricks to. And so he would say, Gertie, can you sit? And then he would play Gertie sitting and bow, and then he'd bow and things like that. I just love that pretty much the first thing humanity does upon discovering that you can draw film frames of film and thus create animation is use it to make dinosaurs.
We really like them.
They're cool.
Well, we liked them until we found out they were feathered, and then we don't like them as much.
No, they're still cool.
Yeah.
You don't like cassowaries and emus?
Oh, that is true. I mean,
New Zealand super eagles?
That is, you have reminded me. Whenever I get a little bit upset that dinosaurs have feathers now, I just remember a giant cassowary would be utterly terrifying.
Yeah. So. It's like T-Rexes. They're just T-Rexes these days are these weird Canadian nerds that just argue with Utahraptors all the time.
That's true.
But a T-Rex with feathers? Oh my goodness me. Giant cassowary.
I mean, birds are scary. I mean, if they were just a little bit bigger.
Oh yeah, have you ever seen an angry pelican?
Oh yeah, I've been bit by a pelican.
Yeah, so, terrifying.
Yeah, they're not great. I've always had this feeling of birds are just these awful, awful creatures. We kind of slept on them. We hate insects and spiders and, you know, sharks and stuff. But secretly,
the birds. I
think birds are kind of...
Hitchcock was right.
Yes, Hitchcock was definitely right.
My favorite pelican story is one time when I was in Manham. And we went to the Manham Bakery and we all had our food. And a friend of mine had a pie in his hand. And there was a pelican walking around. And then he looked away to talk to me. And when he looked back, the pelican had eaten his pie.
I like how we're doing everything possible to not talk about Snow White and Seven Dwarves. As good as that pelican story is, it's just like, we're just really trying to slow this down as much as possible.
Well then, let's talk some more about Disney's brand. We're one of the many parts, and we'll be certainly going over Disney's branding techniques as we talk about this film.
Sure.
And something that happened over the course of developing the brand is ascribing his animators as some sort of mysterious amorphous blob. When we talked about Fantasia and Fantasia 2000 in particular, we spent a lot of time complaining about those animators at Disney had this idea.
Yeah.
And that there's no attribution to any sort of creativity. It's just a cog in the machine of whimsy and magic that is Disney.
Because they actually did... at least say individuals' names right in the first one, didn't they? Or at least they would say, at least name the composers, I guess. I mean,
they named the composers, but not the animators.
Yeah. All right.
It went from weird Disney to the animators at Disney in 2000.
Yeah, okay.
So this film's a bit weird in that it actually credits all the animators at the start. There's about 20 of them who worked on the film, and there's 9 in particular who all worked for Disney at this time. Would go on to be affectionately referred to him by him as the 9 old men. From quite an early age into their career, they're all in their late 20s, early 30s at Snow White's production. But they became the 9 old men, and they were important for being the pioneers in writing down and documenting the theory of what they're actually doing to construct visual meaning in animation. And so I'm just going to quickly go through who they were. So there was Les Clark, who was one of the first animators on Mickey Mouse. He became one of their film directors over time. Films including Cinderella, Alice in Wonderland, Peter Pan, Lady and the Tramp. Everyone's favourite well-meaning but ultimately terrible and horribly offensive film, Song of the South. You've been complaining about boring films, Matt?
Yes, I have.
Wait until I make you watch Song of the South. I'm not going to.
That's nice. We could watch entertaining films every once in a while.
We did.
It could be a thing.
There was Mark Davis, who was the animator of characters such as Maleficent and Cruella de Vil. So, some very fun, charismatic villains there. He was also the character designer for the Pirates of the Caribbean ride. There was Ollie Johnston, who was instrumental in working out the staging for how villains should move and be framed in shots. And perhaps the most notable example I have written down here is Prince John in the Robin Hood movie. That movie's not very good. And there's other reasons to resent it as an animation nerd, such as all the cells from the Jungle Book that were destroyed to make it.
I hate hearing about those stories.
Oh, those are sad stories. There's Milk Carl, who was a pioneer in creating really energetic, bouncy characters like Tigger and Winnie the Pooh. A lot of Pinocchio's motion for the character Pinocchio was done by him. There's Ward Kimball, who was one of the more surreal-oriented artists. So if you've ever seen Alice in Wonderland, he did characters like the Mad Hatter and the Cheshire Cat. He also made a very fiercely anti-Vietnam War short in 1968 entitled Escalation, which was not released through Disney, funny enough. Basically, in his spare time on his own money, he would make duplicate prints of it and go around to film festivals, universities, and just wherever he traveled and try to dish out copies of it to get it out there. Especially as the 1968 election rolled around, he was really, really, really against the Johnson government. Eric Larson was a guy who is mostly notable for becoming internally one of their best trainers and mentors, for actually teaching to the next generations of animators all the stuff that he'd worked out. There was John Lounsbury, who was a squash and stretch expert, which impacted a lot his training. I'll be talking about techniques in a bit. There was Wolfgang Reitman, who was basically the guy that headed up the production and direction roles after Walt Disney's death, before they had more specialized directors. He also animated the fight with Maleficent at the end of Sleeping Beauty, which is pretty much the best looking thing in the Walt Disney era of the company. Like, you could use that and set Dark Souls music to it, and it would be very cool. There was, finally, Frank Thomas, who, along with Ollie Johnston, was a co-writer in writing The Illusion of Life, which was first published in 1981, which was basically the animator's bible, a compilation of all that they'd learned and worked out in how to actually animate. And they compiled most of what they'd written as what they dubbed 12 Principles of Animation. And the aim was to have a look that would be stylized somewhat, but ultimately in service of accurately conveying physics in a different medium to film. So, while it wouldn't look the same as how film would shoot these things, your brain would say, yeah, that's how things are supposed to move. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to list these out one by one. And Matt, I'm going to see if you can just tell me what you think these mean and how they might apply to conveying visual meaning. So the first principle is squash and stretch. This is honestly one of the trickier ones.
To be honest, all I can think of is just like when they... It's like when they completely smash a character in a cartoon and they just
sort it goes of flat in the middle. All right. Just scratch them out. Suppose that we're drawing a ball falling to the ground. The base assumption of how you would draw this is that you have several frames of a circle falling towards the ground, then several frames after its contact with the ground moving up away from the ground. What you do is on the frames as it's approaching the ground, you actually elongate it vertically. So it's not a circle anymore, it's actually an oval, and it gets more and more ovular the closer it is to the ground. Then when it hits the ground, you turn it into a horizontal oval. And then, as it springs away from the ground, it goes back into a vertical oval, and then retains its circular shape as it's completely moved away from the ground. Basically, you're using this little visual trickery to increase the fluidity of the motion, that everything has life to it and is more organic than you would assume by default that it actually is. So in some ways, it's a personification trick, and you can apply this to pretty much any object you move at any time. The next one is anticipation.
Anticipation.
Think of this in wrestling terms, if that might help. It's the exact same idea there.
Well, when I think of anticipation and wrestling, I just think of like a wrestler falling correctly and the wall taking a bump correctly.
So suppose, okay, Shawn Michaels.
Okay.
So Shawn Michaels is going to superkick someone.
Sure.
What does he do?
Ah, oh, well, he toots up the van.
So he stomps, he stomps, he stomps. He leans back and then thrusts right in.
Ah, that reminds me of like, just like how in like in character action games, how they have a lot more frames when they pull back, when
yes,
they telegraph an attack, yep, and then
that is anticipation.
Okay.
So it's all about you really accentuate the stuff that telegraphs the move, the early frames of the animation to indicate I am going to do this specific motion. And the brain sees that. And even before you've animated it, the brain is thinking, they're gonna do this.
Yeah.
That person has raised their fist back. They're going to punch something. That person is reaching back because they're trying to stretch out and grab someone. Likewise, you then combine, if say you were desperately trying to catch someone falling off a triff, you of course bunch them down a bit more to use the squash and stretch technique, and then really stretch them out vertically, lengthways, when they're trying to reach.
Yeah, it seems like with a lot of these, like already I can see like with these techniques, it's not just one technique, it's using them in concert.
Yeah, they're all in concert, all work. The third one is staging. Matt's nodding here. This should be pretty obvious.
No, sorry. I just nodded because...
Yep.
No, I did not. Staging. It's just like a... Is it just like a background setting of like...
Close. It's basically the cinematography.
Okay.
This is the term that they developed, but it means the cinematography. Okay. And even when we were watching Snow White, like the camera was definitely an active participant in a lot of shots. It moved around. It did stuff. Not the best stuff, but it was definitely more active than it was in, say, the Cabinet of Dr. Caligari.
Yeah.
Fourth is straight ahead action versus pose to pose. I think I'll just cut you off on this one unless you can tell me straight away.
Well, it's...
I think I've talked about this before. Basically, it's the idea of animating frame by frame versus animating in keyframes. So in straight ahead action, what you do is as you're drawing, you just draw each incremental frame of the movement in one go. Really good examples of this that we've seen so far would be the Firebird in the Firebird sequence of Fantasia 2000. Yeah. Oftentimes things like wind and fire and all the rain shots towards the end of Snow White, those are usually just drawn frame by frame. You're just slowly, incrementally moving the rain along the screen. Whereas pose to pose is the Disney name for keyframes. You draw the most important steps of the motion first, and then you fill in the details later with the other frames. This is how it's quite often a more economical way of constructing things. It's also what a lot of anime does, and it's how, at its finest, anime often has this really strong sense of moments. You can have really good momentary motion when you're using pose-to-pose techniques. This is also how things like Flash handle all of their animation. That's perhaps the best example. If you look at really early 2000s Flash animations, the easiest way is to look at Homestar Runner and watch the Powered by the Cheat shorts, because they're satirizing this, where there's way too much difference between the keyframes established. So as Flash tries to automate the in-between process, everything just briefly turns into abstract shapes that get reformed into the next part of the frame.
So, you said the how anime uses it really well. Does that mean that even though it's something that can be used economically, there are times when, like, is it sometimes better to use keyframes than to use straightforward? Or if you had the money and the resources, would it always be better to do straightforward animation?
It depends on what sort of thing you're trying to convey. The more fluid something is, and the more amorphous something is, it's a lot easier to do straight ahead. Because you don't need to be as rigid with what the actual shapes and identity of each actor involved is. Sure. Whereas with keyframes, it's a lot easier to remain on model.
That's a good thing to know. Yes. I really like that one, actually. That's an interesting thing to know.
Number five is follow through and overlapping action.
Follow through and overlapping action. I guess that's just what we talked about, anticipation before. This sounds like the opposite thing, like trying to make sure that your animation looks okay after it's basically completed.
Close, that's a part of it. So generally those are referred to as the action and the reaction.
Sure.
What this refers to is, using Snow White as our example, there's that scene where the Queen is walking down to her dungeon, and she's got that billowing cape behind her, and you went, hey, that looks really cool.
It did look really cool.
And really helps convey a domineering presence as she's walking. That is what follow-through and overlapping action are about. Use other parts of the object that's moving to accentuate the main action that's occurring. So if someone has a cope, has a cloak or a cape, and they really want to look intimidating, then you have it billow behind them as they're moving. This is where things like clothing details are really handy, because also things like hair. So say you're reaching back to punch someone. If you've got long hair and the hair also unnaturally moves back with the fist, then it creates that greater sense that the object as a whole is performing that one action. That's not just a limb on a person. The whole person is the punch.
Because you'd have someone, like, shrinking away, like, if they were scared in some way. You just have, like, they might shrink away even, like, to an unrealistic
proportion. Yes. That's a good example. Like, in stage, you often will do this sort of thing where if someone is being very confident, then they'll stand straight with their arms right out. And if you're needing to be more submissive in a momentary interaction with other characters on the stage, then you'll actually slightly crouch and hunch your shoulders forward to make yourself look physically smaller, to indicate that the power dynamic has shifted.
And that's what Clark Kent does to pretend that he's not Superman.
This is all Clark Kent does.
Clark Kent is actually a great animator. We didn't talk about that, but that's true.
Number six, slow in, slow out.
No, I haven't got nothing for that one.
So this is something that... Okay, let's use a very modern example. When you're seeing a modern movie abusing the crap out of slow motion, like, say, our favorite punching bag, Zack Snyder.
Sure.
And you know how the slow motion will go...
Yeah.
It's that. Sometimes plays around being the opposite of this, but basically, you slow down and stretch out the frames at the start of an action at the and the end of an action. So, with our example of someone leaning back to punch,
yeah,
then you have lots and lots of frames of him leaning back, and lots of him slowly moving his fist forward, and then once you're close to the actual connection, wham! You do really quickly for the contact, and then you slowly pull the fist away. Wrestling will also do this.
It's confusing because it just says slow. It's slow in, slow out, but there's a fast section in between. So that's why the description is confusing. But fair enough. Like I see what you mean. And it's just confusing because you know there's a fast point in the middle of that.
This is always the concern with developing internal nomenclature. That people develop labels, and it's because you've got complex ideas that you want to be able to convey to other people in the same field quickly and efficiently. But when people who aren't a part of that field then hear these words, then they're going to make assumptions based on how they've seen these words or fragments of these words used in other sorts of parts of their lives. And this is something that part of what makes people so disdainful of academia is that academics will use lots of weird words. And it's not because they're rubbing in that they're smarter than you. It's because these are what you need to get into the habit of using to convey information quickly and effectively with your peers. But then when you don't hear, when you're out of the system, you don't know what these mean. And you need to actually stretch things back out to unpack them for people.
Yeah, I guess. And as well, you also have to make sure that you're always aware. I feel like if you keep using these with academia or the kind of nomenclature, you can kind of, you start just using the word and you kind of forget the meaning behind it, which can also be a big problem.
This is also where you can intentionally draw as many words from as many different academic fields as you want to make something seem smarter and deeper than it actually is.
Yeah. But I do
this may or may not be a dig at a certain book that is now on all the book best-selling lists at the moment.
Yeah, because we're always very subtle about the things we don't like. But no, it does sound like a very interesting technique, you know, like trying to slow something down. It's weird because...
Have you ever played the Samurai Kirby minigame in Kirby's Fun Pack?
No, I have not. I've only played one Kirby game.
Oh, have you ever seen any sort of samurai anime where you'll have two samurai and they're glaring at each other and they slowly prepare to draw their swords? And then there's a rapid flash.
Yeah.
And then they're both the other side of each other.
Yes.
That's slow in, slow out.
Slow in, slow out. Okay, it's interesting that it's like, it sounds so similar to like anticipation and stuff.
Yeah, so it ties into anticipation, but it's also how you construct the reaction after you've done the first action and anticipatory part.
Okay.
Number 7, arcs.
Arcs. First thought was character arcs, obviously. This is animation, so that's not what we want.
Number 7, arcs. The fundamental component of character animation is monomyth theory.
Hey, it could still be important. Arcs. No, I couldn't really think of it in like the most basic form of like an arc of how you throw something or how an animation goes.
Yes.
Okay.
That is literally it. Oh, okay. All motion in nature moves on a curve.
Sure.
And this is where studying animation, studying movement over and over again is really important, because any motion that you want to draw, if you want to do it effectively, you need to convey the curve that it moves along. And lots of different objects will have different curves. And if you grasp these and the angles that they go at, then you can have motion that feels really, really intuitive and natural. I should dig up some examples. There's an excellent piece on summarizing all these principles that uses examples from the Darkstalkers fighting games, because the animators at Capcom who were working on that game were all classically trained animators. There was this weird period where Capcom had internally this big bunch of Disney fanboy animators who were all classically trained. There's things like that Goof Troop game for the Super Nintendo by Capcom.
Well,
Darkstalkers and Street Fighter 3 are the pinnacle of this animation's traditional work. They are gorgeous. Like, you just look at it and you think, that looks really good. And you instantly understand every character and their motivations just by the way they move.
Well, yeah, it's, I mean, we're talking about film animation right now. We've watched a few shorts as well, but it is interesting. Like every almost all of those things that you were talking about, my first thought, if I did think about animation and get even close to it, was probably about video games rather than actual movies. Like all of it was like, oh yeah, that's how that works in a character action game, or like in a Dark Souls, or anything really.
Number 8 is secondary action.
Well, we talked.
Yeah, this is essentially it's kind of a subcategory of follow through.
Yeah.
But it also allows for counteractions. A great example is, this is a big part of why animals are very popular for animation, even when you're being quite serious in your tone, is because animals have things like tails, which are secondary body attributes that can accentuate a personality. If a tail is being really frisky, it indicates something different to when it's being careful and calm.
Yeah, I was, when I was talking about shrinking earlier, well, I had that idea of like people shrinking away to show that they're scared, and the way you can try and shrink them down even more. Like, actually, the thing I was actually most thinking about was like a rabbit or something, like with its ears like folding back, or a dog's tail like tucking under, that kind of a thing.
Yes. Number 9 is timing. This should be pretty obvious.
Or just the timing of your animations, I guess.
Yep. Just making sure that things move in a way that seems intuitive. Yeah. This is also where things about momentum often come in. Just make sure that the gait and the cadence and pacing of how things move is appropriate for how they look and for what meaning you're wanting to convey by how they move. Number 10 is exaggeration.
Well, clearly you want... you need to be a bit more clear, I think, with how motions are.
Yes.
I mean motions just in terms of walking around or moving around, just how anything moves. I feel like animation, you probably want to exaggerate just to make it clear
what's going on. It's all about making things as unambiguous as you can by making them that little bit larger than life. This is Shawn Michaels tuning up the band. This is what exaggeration is. Yeah. The anticipation is Shawn Michaels leaning back and getting ready for his kick, but him stomping the ground and things like that, that definitely comes under exaggeration.
I feel like would be more interesting to talk about in regards to exaggeration. Is there ever a time, because I've always heard this, about animation, whether it's video games, movies, whatever, that you should be very clear and you always be exaggerated with kind of motions. Is there ever a time where it can be worth trying to be a bit more subtle? Or is that just a really bad idea that will just never work?
It works as a contrasting element most often, where if you need to have really understated animations to convey things about personality and moments, in that case it's the I'm not in yes we are all individuals I'm not from Life of Brian last week. The key thing is it needs to be visually distinct, because that in its own way is a form of exaggeration. The fact that it's understated compared to everything else. Things like the Bruce Timm Justice League series, everything feels a little bit too unexaggerated for my liking in that. And so oftentimes, characters and situations just feel flat and uninspiring to me. And it's because there isn't quite that level of exaggeration that I would like.
Is that just with the Justice League, or like the entirety of Bruce Timm's kind of universe?
It varies from text to text. Yeah. A lot of Batman the Animated Series, I think, handles exaggeration in the right amounts. Superman is a bit inconsistent. By Justice League, it feels like everyone's sticking way too hard to the model sheets at all times and all moments.
Yeah. It's funny.
A lot of the later Bruce Timm animated movies that pop up now and then often feel like this to me as well.
Yeah, it is funny. I remember when you said it was Bruce Timm, the Justice League, I was like, I bet he probably likes Batman a bit more than...
Yeah.
And I'm the same. I really liked how just how Batman looked in terms of visuals and animation. The animated series, and then I remember when it went starting going to the more Justice League kind of direction, I was like, I'm the same.
That little bit more lifeless.
Yeah.
The other concern with Justice League comes in with number 11 here, which is solid drawing.
Okay.
So what this refers to is, in particular, you want enough detail in everything you draw to really understand the volume and scope of all actors and components of your shots. So this is like how in film you need the correct sort of costuming to convey your tone and your setting and your meaning. With solid drawing is the animation equivalent of that.
Okay. Yeah, it sounds pretty basic.
Yep. But, you know, it needs to be on the list as a core part of good animation is be good at drawing and conveying the things you want to convey. And then number 12 is the ultimate in ambiguous, overall encompassing things. Appeal.
Well, I was just thinking with 11 and now with this the same, it's like sometimes even, doesn't matter what the medium is, there are going to be things that are universal and...
Yeah.
With animation and...
It's the same with staging. Staging is just learn to use your camera properly.
Yeah. So what was 12 exactly again?
Appeal. So, yeah, like, have some sort of hook to everything you draw that makes it appropriately eye-catching.
Yeah. I guess that's probably harder in practice than it is in theory.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's about looking at what... It's combining all these other 11 concepts and seeing, like, what is it about the character that you're trying to convey through visuals?
And so these 12 concepts, what we're saying is, were they kind of developed by these...
So this is the way that the nine old men internally developed and labeled these concepts when they talked to each other and started training new employees.
So this would be like their blueprint?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. This is where they developed The Illusion of Life. Their book from 1981 was comprised of these 12 steps and... They're explaining in detail what they meant by them and how to achieve life, living animation.
Well, they... I mean, I'm obviously not an expert in animation at all, but they sound, like, solid to me. Like,
yep. So as I sucker you into animation through the rest of this show, however long it goes for, now you've got a list of steps that you can look at and assess when things don't look quite right. Now you should hopefully have a better understanding of one of these things isn't being done right, like, say, the slow-in, slow-out was ignored utterly, as were the arcs of motion in the sword fights at the end of Heavy Metal.
Yeah, I'll go back to that. That was genuinely awful.
Yeah, the timing, like, the timing was bad, the exaggeration was bad, there was some degree of volume, I guess, there was no sort of overlapping action, it also really didn't help that she wore so little. And so there was nothing, no other parts of her body that could accentuate things. As a note, this is why a lot of animators in across cultures and disciplines, if they're drawing things like a woman with boobs, they will quite often use things like breast jiggle as a part of a follow-through. That's just like, here is a part of the body that can move, so we will use it in service of the motion.
You could use her hair. You could do
which
that.
Is also used well.
Yeah.
But if they got short hair?
We could, if you're listening to this and... You've just heard us talk about these like 12 principles. I suppose looking back at how our Heavy Metal, our podcast of Heavy Metal might be decent. Yeah.
I went through like half of these in the cut version of the audio from Heavy Metal that we lost.
Oh, okay.
So here's a definitive list for the future.
Yeah. Just in case you needed more evidence that Heavy Metal is terrible, we have offered some more right now.
Your rankings of worst film on the show so far.
It's obviously not as bad as Ben-Hur or Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. It's probably not as bad as Heavy Metal. It's
a solid fourth place.
Well, the thing is, I guess...
How does it compare to Watership Down?
Oh, that's tough. I was going to compare it, I'll keep that in mind, but I was going to compare it just to... It's like all the Disney films, actually. Fantasia 2000 that we've watched so far has that same thing of just like, it wasn't horrible. But it wasn't good. It was just...
You felt nothing.
I felt nothing.
But no, one scene you felt mirth.
Oh, yes. As always, just like how in like... We've talked about WWE before, so it's fine to bring it up. It's the same way like when WWE is really dull, often the villains are the most... are what give you the most joy. In the same way in Disney films that are very dull and simple, often you'll get the most joy out of just a villain who's enjoying themselves.
Yes, there's a notorious film entitled Home on the Range, the final animated feature film in traditional animation before the unit got shut down. This is before John Lasseter briefly resurrected it for The Princess and the Frog. That film, I should go look at it again. It's probably less terrible than I remember, but it's from a period where the unit's about to be shut down and no one cares. And it's somewhat notorious for the villain song, the classic villain song being a yodeling song. It's utterly absurd, and honestly, I love it. It's probably the best part of that film, is the wacky cow hustler yodeling to hypnotize cows and steal them.
What a guy.
It's just, you know, like 9 years before was Hellfire.
Yeah. I mean, like, obviously when I'm talking about, like, the villain, we're talking about the queen, obviously, because we're talking about Snow White and Seven Dwarfs.
All right, we're talking about Snow White.
Yes. We have to do it at some point. It is technically going to be on the title of the podcast, I think. But the queen is the only one who's at all interesting in this.
And it's not for the first two scenes she's in.
No, she's terrible in those scenes. if we're going to go right to the start. I think I had a comment that, like, the main story premise is just so dull and boring and banal that even criticizing it feels dull and boring and banal. Because, like, everyone knows.
What can we contribute at this point?
Yeah.
As a further reminder, if you've never really thought about the Disney aesthetic and what it means, that Walt's goal was to create a family-friendly, all-ages product. And a vibe and an aesthetic that was all about just this safe, friendly place where dreams come true. I was tempted to do Pinocchio, but we'll save that for another time.
A better time, probably.
That is a better film. It's also the one where the message of Disney is much clearer, that when you wish upon a star, dreams will come true, becoming a part of the company's ethos.
Yeah, there's very little in terms of, like no one actually has a dream, really.
Yeah.
I mean, like, people have motivations, I guess, but there's no, like, magical, like... I mean, Snow White is obviously far too pure and kind to really want anything, really, in life. She just wants to keep singing to people, really.
Keep singing and be married, as that is the expected role of her.
Yeah. And I feel like with her, like, we keep having this theme, I feel like, I mean, almost every podcast, we have a character that is just impossible to relate to or to be invested in. I'm thinking about Henry and Booker Henry and...
greatest human being alive.
Yeah. And Mr. Smith in Washington, like, just these perfect heroic characters that... And as I keep saying, like, I tend to be that one person, or I tend to be that person who enjoys that kind of, like...
You like to cheer the lead baby face.
Yeah, so it's always annoying to me when I see these characters like, say, Smith, Henry, or Snow White, when they're just so boring. There's just nothing to them at all. I guess it's because I don't need that much, but there's just nothing here. So it
won't
annoying.
Even give you the most basic of needs.
Yeah, and she is just... Yeah, she's impossible to relate to. There's nothing to her. I didn't even like the voice actress that much. It's probably not her fault. She's probably just how she was directed to talk. But she talked in a very... it was like she's talking to children the whole film.
Mm-hmm.
Which patronizing. She was, but yeah, that's for... Yeah, patronize is a great word. So I guess that makes it...
Not as in Snow White as patronizing, but like the voice of the film is patronizing to the viewer.
Sure.
Especially when she has a line which is something like, "I feel really happy now," and Matt cowered in shame in the corner of my eye at the time.
Well, it was because, like, when she said that, I mean, everyone knows the plot to Snow White and Seven Dwarfs, but at this point in the film, she'd been attacked by the huntsman, and he couldn't do it. She ran away. So she's lost, which probably wasn't that great, but still, she's been attacked. She's in the woods. She's in an unfamiliar place. And I think she meets the animals and she has, like, a song with them. And that's when she says it.
Yes.
"I feel so happy now." What?
It's like if you've ever been to a children's show at a shopping center. When they say, "Well done, thanks for your help in cheering up Bugs Bunny, children."
Yeah.
Where's Daffy Duck? Oh, is he behind me?
It's not a film or a story at that point. It's just... it's just something to make kids feel happy, I guess.
Yeah.
They want the kids to be happy, so the main character is happy.
Mm-hmm.
Be happy. Enjoy this film.
We have gone past the scary bit.
Yes.
We've gone past the interesting visual stylization.
Yes.
There's those wonderful bits as she's running through the woods. And this is certainly a look which came back in numerous other Disney films. In particular, Beauty and the Beast has basically this scene, but with better narrative behind it. So you actually care when Bella's scared by all the wolves and the scary eyes in the woods. But what is neat here is there's a couple of times she gets caught in branches, and they briefly turn into clawing hands gripping at her.
Yeah.
And the whole thing is, the ultimate point of this sequence is that she is scared by what is in the woods, but then when she calms down and gets a greater insight into what's there, she realizes it's actually just a bunch of friendly animals. You could do something with that, but this film doesn't.
No, they don't. It's annoying because you make it sound... I don't want to say that you make it sound better than it is, because it is probably one of the better scenes.
Yes, it's one of the two good scenes.
Yeah, but I guess it's good for the visuals rather than that interesting idea if she gains more insult and insight and learns that everything isn't awful. If you changed the film a little bit, I had an idea that, like, you could have a situation like she's part of royalty, maybe she's always, like, disdained or just not really liked the people that lives in the woods. She's got, like...
Yep.
Bad feelings towards them, and so when and you establish that
you tell beforehand. you tell a story yeah. of political intrigue and isolation,
yeah,
and it's only through embracing the greater parts of the land and the people that she can then become the leader who is worthy of usurping an abusive authority. Snow White and the Huntsman, my second favorite film of all time, kind of tries to do this, but what's her face from Twilight has the charisma of a wet flannel, and so it sucks. Fortunately, my favorite film of all time, The Huntsman Winter's War, oh my God, has none of that, and is just
podcast right now.
Just Chris Hemsworth and his axe, and some goofy sidekicks, and he's got to beat up Angelina Jolie because she's back from the dead, and now she's a figure of gold to contrast with the new evil sisters. Figure of silver, and they become giant tentacle-ridden Dark Souls bosses. And we know that I can make Dark Souls jokes because Chris Hemsworth does the dodge roll with the same animation. we just watch those movies? Why did I do this to you?
I don't know why. Yeah, this sounds much better. I do, unfortunately, I let it go before, and now I realize I made a horrible mistake.
You can't hold it back anymore.
No. I mean,
you see, I did a Frozen thing there. Frozen thing,
yeah. I think it might have been not Angelina Jolie. I think it might have been Charlize Theron who did.
That's it, Charlize Theron. Yeah.
And
yeah.
Then there's another British actor I can never remember the name of. Would be her sister.
But yeah, they're awesome.
I think I would have much preferred watching that movie. Although, just like in that movie, the villain is the most
yes.
character.
Oh, yes.
No offense to Chris Hemsworth, who is often quite good.
He's definitely having some fun in the second one, but yeah. Charlize Theron is channeling... She's channeling some John Travolta in Battlefield Earth. In the, I'm not sure if you've seen those movies.
Oh, yeah, I've seen Battlefield... Oh, no, the Huntsman.
Yeah, yeah.
No,
I've not seen yeah, yeah. Those. Like, she has the same cadence of that speaking slow and softly. How dare you betray me! It's awesome.
I guess I haven't watched Battlefield Earth for a long time, so maybe instead I'll just watch The Huntsman and call it that.
Basically the same movie.
Yeah. What were we saying? Oh yeah,
all right, so
the forest. Yeah, I would say that, like, just in general, I think, like, forests and swamps tend to be really good in the film. They're a great location for any kind of story.
Yep.
Just because they're so easily scary.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And you could even do a story where it's like, there's a scary, mean, rude thing in the swamp. But it learns to empathize. And also teaches the princess that true beauty's on the inside. And she should also be a Shrek.
Oh my God.
So.
I was almost going to... Yeah, well, just move on.
So back to Disney and cultural appropriation.
Sure.
Yeah, so the Disney aesthetic also includes just taking other cultures and traditions, fairy tales. There are compilations of fairy tales. There are traditions which have been tabulated and passed on through and transformed through all sorts of cultures. For example, the first instance of the Cinderella story is not Achin Putl. It's actually a Chinese folk story to begin with. And it got passed along through the first construction of a Silk Road, was how it passed through the European nations in the wake of the Roman Empire. And initially it had golden shoes and a magic talking fish instead of a fairy godmother as part of its features. You know, golden shoes makes more sense than glass, but there was a time when glass was more valuable than gold, so it got transmuted by that through time.
Through an alchemist.
And so the ultimate, what I'm getting to is that Snow White was a German folktale from part of the Brothers Grimm compilation. But what Walt was going for with all of the adaptations was, it doesn't matter what culture they come from now, we're going to remove as much as we can of any of the ethnic elements of the film, of the stories, and just create this homogenous, I guess, if it almost is part of creating a mythology for America. in particular white post-colonial America. That, yeah, there's always been people here, and I guess America, too, might have had, like, magic ancient kingdoms. And they had stories like Snow White in them, I guess.
Yeah, and it...
Like, Pinocchio is an Italian story, and there's a guy called Geppetto in it, but it's not a very Italian-feeling film.
Well, I guess it's like, it's... Maybe this is too much of a claim. This might be a stretch, so I apologize if it is, but I'm reminded of the way when Rome was the biggest power in the world, the way it would bring things from other cultures and make it a part of their own mythology and their own world. Maybe that's just something...
I mean, like, assimilation is a fine part of creating, like, greater national unity.
Yeah.
But there's also a lot of just removing all of the parts which made the story interesting and, like, sure. This... takes any sort of and oftentimes the process of the way that Disney adapted fairy tales was all about just removing any sort of actual modernist meaning to them, and that they are just there to be safe, happy, fluffy nothing. They are there to be a bit of sugar for you to eat.
Yeah, and as well as just the way, like, it kind of seems like it contextualized kind of not just fairy tales, but also just animation in general as something for children.
Yes.
And something that is just for wholesome or just, as you say, a little bit of sugar. And it did make probably the most interesting thing about this film was just me, like, wondering, like, what would a different world would look like if instead the first feature animation for a cartoon or an animation was made for adults or had, like, a proper story to it. Or if the first, like, really, popular adaptation of a fairy tale in, like, America or in the Western world was something that didn't take away all those interesting aspects of them and was more contextualized as, oh, these fairy tales are about from other cultures and have some value in that. Like, what would that world look like? But unfortunately, instead, we get Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, which is what it is.
Which is a fun ride at Disneyland. Because we were talking about the scary forest, and you can go on a little roller coaster, which is just that sequence of the film. So there's really only one more thing to talk about, and we've alluded to it before, and that is that wonderful, wonderful scene where the evil queen becomes evil on the outside as well with her disguise. The mad cackling she engages in, the sheer glee she has at now that she's shed herself of her kayfabe, that she can just do whatever the hell she wants now that she's overtly a heel.
Yeah, because she's not very interesting in, like, her first few scenes. Which is because, like, that's just them. She's in scenes that set up a story that is rather dull and not very interesting. But then when she realizes that Snow White is still alive, and she, even though she's a queen, she decides she's going to take this. At least she's a doer. She doesn't send any more lackeys to do the job. She's like, I'm going to deal with this myself. Which is pretty good for a queen. I really seem to respect this woman a lot for some reason. And she decides to...
But look, she had a book on her shelf, which, based on the position the word was written, it was either an author or a publisher. So she has a book labeled Black Magic, and either the author or the publishing firm is named Death.
So good. I like how they only did that for one of the books.
Yes.
Like, all the other books are blank at that.
They're all public domain.
Spot. Yeah, public domain.
Like, the Book of Disguises, public domain. Yeah. You can just go into a library and print that off as many times as you want.
Yeah.
But the Black Magic book.
And it's actually a really good scene, actually. Like, just in terms of visuals. At
yes.
And, like, the foley that's using the sounds. Like, just her changing from, like, a, you know, the queen, regal queen, into the old crone or hag, whatever you want to... Yes. Call it the Baba
Yaga. There is an evil bird. There is an evil raven in there. But her evil and malice is so great that even the bird is horrified.
Yeah, it's like a crow version of Worf or something, like an evil version of Worf, where it's like it's this evil bird, but even the bird is like, oh God.
So mortified by what she's become. And she what makes all this mad cackling so great is she concludes that if she puts a sleeping death on Snow White, then the dwarves will just bury her. And she finds the idea of being buried alive incredibly funny.
Yes. Just starts laughing at it and, like, repeating the words over.
She cannot stop laughing at burying someone alive.
She's so happy.
And she's so happy about this that as she's leaving her dungeon, she sees the skeleton of some other poor prisoner who's been long, long dead.
Should have terrified me.
Grasping near a jar of water. And so she looks at it, laughs some more and goes, ha, you're thirsty? Have a drink! Kicks the jar at the skeleton and laughs her head off as the skull rolls along the ground.
So good. Like, I don't even know if, like, even if Charlize Theron hasn't seen anything close to that. would you say that anything compares, like, in The Huntsman?
No.
No.
Like, there is a general vibe of wacky camp evil villain in a bad movie.
Sure.
Whereas this is just, you'll remember, are you thirsty, have a drink.
Yeah. And it's like, it's, even before she did that, just like when I saw the skeleton reaching for, like, its bucket, like, a bucket that's clearly empty by this point. And it's just, like, even just that, I was like, whoa, that's crazy for a children's film. And then,
Disney films will get away with some stuff when it comes to death. And this one had that wonderful montage editing to do everything but directly show Arok crushing the queen to death.
Which is also another good scene. I feel like any scene that was either dark or was like had something menacing in it, like so the swamp scene, the scene where she's changing to a hag, and then the final scene with the witch anyway, when she dies, like they seem like the best scenes that were.
Yeah, it's often the case in Disney films that this is what happens, and it's easy to assume. Then oftentimes the lesson that was taken from this is you need to be darker and edgier. And this is what leads to the plethora of Family Guy knockoffs we are still cursed with to this day. But it's not that you need to be darker than edgier. These work because they really want you to revile and be somewhat afraid of these villains. And thus they put the most effort into eliciting emotional response for you. Thus you're at your most engaged at these points.
Yeah.
And if they put as much care into the hours and hours of dwarves tripping over each other, looking for someone sleeping in their room and trying to wash each other and scramble for some food. And those scenes just drag on and on and on. And you just don't care anymore.
Yeah, I feel
these short, sharp, dark moments. You go, whoa, I'm feeling something again. This is why a lot of the Renaissance Disney movies are so good. Is because you actually care about the good guys. Like, Aladdin has scenes where he's just being, and Jasmine both have wonderfully charismatic scenes. The Lion King, pretty much everyone in that film was a delight to watch talking and doing things. You got Simba as this energetic guy, then this mopey teenager. You got Rafiki as the wacky guy, Timon and Pumbaa as the fast-talking, worldly men. Scar is wonderful as well. Zazu is, you know, it's Mr. Bean. Why have I forgotten his name? I keep wanting to say Anthony Hopkins for some reason, and it's not.
No, it's not Anthony Hopkins. Sorry,
how the hell have I forgotten Mr. Bean Blackadder guy? I'm cutting this bit because I'm mad now.
just edit over it, shouting his name out. Really, like, complete. Obviously, you're in a different room.
Holy crap, I've completely forgotten it. This is terrible. Like, the point is, and that's part of why The Lion King is one of the best films the company ever made, is you're engaged the whole time. Everyone is interesting. And you care about what happens to them.
Which is definitely not true of Snow White and Seven Dwarfs.
Like, the most fun we had in all the dwarf scenes was joking about Grumpy being an MRA.
Yeah. I think, because when we started talking about The Witch, we said this will be the last thing we talk about. I feel like it's good that we did talk about this, because we'd be remiss in talking about all these things about Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs and not mentioning, oh, wait, actually 90% of this film is dreadfully dull.
Yep.
There's not much you can say about them, but it should just be mentioned. Yeah, there's a lot of scenes in this movie that are...
Snow White is boring. Don't watch it. You were saying, while we were off the air briefly, that you feel like we aren't accentuating enough how boring certain films are and that you shouldn't watch them.
Yeah.
So you want to really put your foot down on and say, watch something else.
Sure.
Watch a Renaissance Disney film. They're all pretty great. The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari from 1920, directed by Robert Weaver. So let me tell you about Expressionism. Are you familiar with that term as an artistic movement?
I think so.
Expressionism was a product of modernist movements. Of course, modernist movements as they pertain to art are about that narrative and texts in any form have intrinsic meaning and are making statements about things. And Expressionism was about trying to visually convey internal thoughts, all about externalization. A classic example of an expressionist painting is The Scream. which is, of course, person wailing and melting, and it's about trying to visually convey that, like, when you're panicking and when you've got anxiety attacks, that you feel like you're melting and that you've got no control. It was a movement that was growing at the in the early stages of the 20th century, and in particular, there's a subset known as German Expressionism, because the impact of the Treaty of Versailles resulted in reduced trade and contact with Germany, which resulted in them encouraging isolationist policies, which resulted in the artists of that time grabbing the whatever ideas they could before they all got shut away, and then just extrapolating further, in particular with Expressionism, especially because through the various issues the Weimar Republic had, and even more so when the Nazi government took control, finding ways to use visual coding to describe things that you want to talk about became really important to work out as quickly as you can. And so a lot of the early German films in this period all tie into expressionist approaches. The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari doesn't have much lighting. This is mostly a budgetary concern, where they couldn't afford very many lights to begin with. The scene with the most lighting is one of the street shots, where there is the studio light so the actors can see what they're doing and the cameras can get the footage, and there's one street light that turns on. That's the most lights that any scene in this film has. The rest is just the studio light. Wow. This was all shot entirely on sound stages, which should be pretty obvious when you think about how it all looks. Yeah. And it's just, well, if we can't afford lighting, then we will use paint and paint the sets with the sort of shadows that convey their location as well as the thematic intent and emotions that are going on in the scenes that are happening in there. And then they went, well, this is stylized as hell, so let's go even further. Let's make everything in the village have the most bizarre, almost non-Euclidean approach to how everything is. It's just all these bizarre triangles and swirls, and there's people who are hunched over when trying to work at desks because the roof is so low at that point. Yet at the same time, their stool is so high that they're perched up in what is a position of power, but it's really, really precarious as well.
Yeah, I really struggled with that, actually. I think, to me, it kind of clashed because at times, like, my thought when I was looking at a lot of it, it felt cartoonish. And I don't think that the movie is supposed to be cartoonish. So I personally, like, even though now that you've explained it to me, it makes more sense. And the creativity of it, I feel like, is good.
Yeah.
For me personally, watching it, it just felt like, I guess in some ways it did their job because it did make me feel weird.
Yeah, confused and on edge and disoriented,
Yeah. Which
is valuable for what was a horror film.
Sure. I guess as well, though, as I say, it also felt a bit cartoonish. And cartoonish doesn't really... It can be horror, obviously, but it can take a little bit of away because it kind of looks like, I don't know, Mr. Bean set at times. This is kind of...
Rowan Atkinson. Rowan Atkinson.
There you go, you did it. I'm annoyed at myself, actually, now. I should have actually remembered that as well. But yeah, it just looks absurd. And I know it was trying to make you feel on edge, and at times it did. Other times it just felt like, is this a children's story? Or is it like, what are you doing with this? Like, you know.
We're making the door a triangle.
It did look interesting, I guess. It did catch my eye. So I guess in that regards, they did well.
And not every expressionist film looks this way.
Sure.
For reference. Other notable expressionist films include things like Nosferatu, M by Fritz Lang. Third Man is often considered one of the early examples of a talkie with expressionist elements in it. Because essentially what happened is most of the people involved with the expressionist movement in film all realized that things were getting bad and they got out of the country as fast as they could and wound up impacting various other film circles in other countries. The director of this one, Robert Weaver, he actually tried to do a remake with sound in 1929 in London, but it didn't go anywhere and he died of cancer in 1938. Other people of the movement, such as Fritz Lang, lived much longer lives, where they could continue to be long, violent assholes. Fritz Lang's an interesting one. He's pretty much your classic overbearing auteur director, where if you've seen things like The Disaster Artist and it tries to argue that Tommy Wiseau is an arsehole, but there's value in having overbearing arseholes heading up projects because you get art. Of course, the problem with it in the context of The Disaster Artist is that The room sucks.
Yeah.
We can get some ironic humor out of it, but it's not good. Yeah. His the pain that he put people through in is not worth the joy it has brought.
And it better be, like, considering it is just art in the end, you know, you would... And especially because, like, something like The Room isn't going to be culturally or politically significant, even if it was really good. You know, like, if you're going to put people through pain, it better be, like, really, really goddamn good. And I feel like, my comfortableness with people going through, like, incredible pain during a movie production is pretty low. I don't really see the...
You pretty much never need to do it.
Yeah.
Like, at worst, you should be Gene Wilder in Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, where he toned things down on the rehearsals in comparison to the final shout.
Yeah. Which is hard, yeah. Which is clever, but not exactly...
Yeah, you... Like, that's or, cool.
Yeah.
How Stanley Kubrick treated everyone on The Shining set? Yeah. Not cool.
Yeah. And this is probably, like, a whole conversation. You could do a whole podcast of that. Like,
yeah. Yeah, I've been thinking about ways to tackle auteur theory. We'll be talking about it a bit on my Valpurgis Night evening, because there's some interesting stuff that went on in the two films I've chosen there. One of them has had an auteur at the helm, but it's also a really good example of collaboration in film, because he intentionally hired a bunch of people to oversee and reinterpret what he'd made, because he wasn't confident that he was going to convey things in the way that he wanted them to be done. And the other film we're going to do that night is the case of a director who wound up being more and more in control of the project than she wanted, because half of her production crew were assholes and tried to kill the film.
Like, I'm intrigued, I will say that.
Oh, though that's going to be an interesting evening. So, Expressionism and German film in the early 20s.
I will say, we were talking earlier about academic time sometimes being confusing. And I guess another thing to add to that is that when you said modernism, even within academia, it can be confusing.
Oh, yeah.
When you say modernism, my thoughts went through a completely different, like, idea.
You were thinking of in IR terms rather than artistic?
Yeah, and I was like, oh, wait, okay, that's not what I...
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, I did mention modernity, but yeah, certainly modernity is more often the term used when discussing IR matters.
Because, you know, that makes it so much more...
Yeah, you just... Yeah, I bring up modernity and you're thinking, wait, what does Hobbes have to do with this? Yeah, exactly. So, like, the intrinsic self-interest of Caligari? like, what is the hard power value of Cesar?
I
was alluding to that as well because of how grossly poorly understood the word postmodern is. As that is a word which has some very, very certain meanings. In particular, in art, where it refers to the value of the meta-discussion over the intrinsic value of a work, and it's been misunderstood to mean arty-farty bullshit. It's like, the point of something like cubism is to look at the structural components of how you construct images, take things down to those barest images, does it still have that intrinsic meaning? Because under modernist theory, it does. In practice, it doesn't. And from understanding this, you understand the value of actually the flourishes that go on top of an artistic text in order to really actually say something.
Yeah, I'm not really too much into that kind of stuff, especially because I wouldn't consider myself an expert either in art or in IR with it. But I guess I would say that I'm definitely on your, like, and with you probably, in that I tend to enjoy postmodern stuff or theories more than modernist theory, whether that be in art or in IR or any kind of piece of academia. So. Yeah, I would agree.
Yeah, postmodernism discussion is an interesting one because generally the answer that most of them lead to is it's somewhere in the middle, which can often come off, particularly in the current political climate, as being wishy-washy sellout behavior. But no, when it comes to understanding art, it really is somewhere in there where you need to be able to understand the construction and the meaning, you need to understand the ways that we disseminate it, how we intentionally misunderstand things. You need to understand that all, and then you have a greater grasp of the value and the effort that goes into making something. We're dancing around topics here a bit, which I think is fine, because The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari is a horror film where a creepy guy has a mind-controlled sleepwalker, which he uses to murder people. It's also accompanied with bookends, which indicate that this isn't actually the case, and that it's all the account of a crazy person in an asylum who's just complaining about the overseer of the asylum. And there's really two ways that you can interpret it based on this. This is also a great example of how I've been saying that endings, not the ending to a text, is not only the emotional beats. And that's what I've focused on when I've rambled about Wonder and Krampus and Ben-Hur. But in this case, it's the recontextualization aspect that this goes from being a story of one man's abuse to power to being recontextualized as the rambles of a crazy man. But there's just enough ambiguity in how they frame the final shot of the director of the asylum and his final line of, "Now I know how to treat him." That, like, you absolutely can interpret this depending on who you think is the hero. If Caligari's the hero, then this is just a kind man who's been misinterpreted by crazy people. Or, if he actually is Caligari, then this is a case of the final success of the villain.
Yeah, when I was watching, I was just very confused. Now that I've got the context of why those bookends were there, I'll probably talk about that a bit later. I guess the one thing is that, unfortunately, there are a few things that debunk it, this theory a lot, even though it's my favorite one coming out of it, that Caligari somehow cut off people. Like, he proved himself innocent somehow. Like, he tricked people into thinking, oh, no, wait, he's just a director, and this guy, the main protagonist, is the crazy person. And I thought the idea was that when he says he's in a cure, I know how to cure him, what he's going to do is he's going to make another somnambulist.
Yes.
Another sleepwalker.
Yeah.
And that would be quite, that's pretty horror kind of standard.
Yeah, yeah.
The hero eventually just turned into another monster.
Mm-hmm, another tool of the system.
Yeah, and I quite liked that. Unfortunately, I guess we should probably, say, like, why those bookends is probably a good time.
Oh, yeah, so. That's the plain statement and depiction of the text. The general reading of this film as early as 1920, given the climate that it's made in, Germany has just come out of a civil war in the wake of World War I. The Weimar Republic is very, very messy in attempting to develop a democratic force. It has to stamp down on a lot of freedoms. There's a lot of violence going on at this time. And there's really, really strong anti-establishment and general mistrust of people in power, which is consistently reflected in all the art of this period, especially as we move towards the Depression, where you get things like the cabaret movement, which is built around being intentionally over the top and flamboyant as a way of protesting the triviality of those who are rich. And then in the Expressionist films, you get a lot of this mistrust of power and fear of others and outsiders and secret intrusions into power structures. Nosferatu, in particular, there's classic shots of his shadow on the wall and the fingers stretching out to grab and throttle. That's the fear there, the fear of these tendrils coming here to take away the way of life that we have just managed to grab onto. And so with Caligari and this respected man in power, this psychiatrist at the head of an asylum, who's slinking around murdering people and abusing his charges, it was interpreted as being a metaphor about the state abusing people and abusing the people who are trying to help make the Republic work. And thus, it was decided to film a couple of bookends where it's, oh, no, 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 that's all just the misconception of the crazy person.
Yeah, so that's why they were, it has an opening scene where he's talking to, he looks like a priest. Is that,
it's just,
cross,
it's, so yeah.
and he says, you don't know how crazy a life I've had, and he starts telling a story, basically, mm-hmm. which is the movie. And then at the end, Well, I guess the bookmark isn't just him talking to the guy. Also, then
yeah, it's asserting that he is a denizen of the asylum.
Yes, and he says, no, Caligari is the crazy person. He's the one who's got this sleepwalker who's killing people, but no one believes him. They drag him away. That his wife is another person.
Yeah, so that's the fun thing, we can have interpretations, because then this ties into something you were commenting on throughout the film, is that the main character is such a passive participant in the events that go around.
Yeah.
And so if we assume that he is actually a denizen of the asylum and is a crazy person, yeah, then you look, this gets into a bit of a Squall is dead on disc one theory, where the reason that there's this very, very minor and very poorly touched on subplot of his friend dies, therefore he gets to hook up with the girl that he's after, is because this is what he wants. He's lusting after this woman who's also in the asylum, who's demonstrated as having zero interest in him.
Yeah.
But in his fantasy, then he gets her, and through overthrowing Caligari, then he's able to... It's through Caligari and his delusions there that he's able to get what he wants. The obstacle to conquering his affection is there. And likewise, he's such a passive participant in all those scenes because as a denizen of an asylum, he cannot grasp the idea of actually having power.
Yeah, and after he gets dragged away, then he goes back to the scene on the bench. And then the guy just backs away from why you really are a crazy person, and then basically that's the end. Oh well, there's that scene where the
doctor, and the doctor goes, "Now I can cure him.
I can cure him. I understand it now." And because of that, I think a situation where you can try to have different takes on what the movie is, like whether he's insane or not. And it's unfortunate to me that the one that I like the most, where he's not a crazy person, it's the Doctor, Caligari, is the villain, and now he's going to turn the main protagonist into one of his sleepwalkers. It doesn't really work because, unfortunately, there's a scene where they go, the main protagonist and a few other people go into the main office, they get
into his diary, and they get to his diary and they learn everything about Caligari being evil. And then they drag Caligari away. So, unfortunately, I think you can only really go with
due to that scene, you're going to assume that it's not.
Yeah, either it's real or it's not. So it's like, unfortunately, my favorite one is kind of debunked by that. And so all you have to do is fall back on the one that the main protagonist is insane, which is a bit of a shame. And I think it is...
So the brutal state wins.
Yeah, the brutal state does win, and...
The Nazis are going to take over.
I don't blame the film.
Is this prophetic for 2018's politics, Matt?
Oh my god. I feel like leading questions are happening here. No, I think it is a shame, because it's a shame that the movie is made worse through the bookmarks, and as much as we try to make it better with our own interpretations, if we really look into it, and with scenes like that, unfortunately it is lessened by those bookmarks. It's not as good, and it would be a better movie without them. And all you can say is it's a shame that when governments decide, or any kind of authority decides, to mess with art in such a way.
Well, it's fine, because that means we had one last bit of bookending. For you see, there was censorship involved here. And whether it was for the whether you think it improves the film or makes it worse is very subjective. There was also a censorship gag in the Warner Brothers short that we started this evening off with. There's a bit where they're saying, get the bird, and one of the cats says, oh, I'll give you the bird, all right, but the censors won't let me.
Oh, did he say that?
Yes. Oh. It's a Warner Brothers short. They're edgy and cool. Of course he said that.
The anti-Disney.
Thanks, Mel Blanc.
So that's the theme. That's the actual connectivity we have. Censorship in film. It's a horrible, horrible thing. No, other than that, I guess one of the things I didn't really enjoy that much in the film was the diary reading scene. Well, I just said that. Even in general, even without the bookmarks.
Yeah, you didn't like the structure of the scenes where they're reading the diary and discovering the truth.
I understand that, as you said when we were watching it, that... it's a horror film, and this is a reasonable way of learning who this is in a horror film.
This is an extremely old horror trope.
Yeah.
This isn't just don't read the evil book in Cabin in the Woods, yeah.
Yeah.
1920.
Yeah, I suppose. So I shouldn't be too upset with it, but I do feel like, so what they do, as I've already explained how the scene goes, they go into his office and they read his diary, and that's how they find out that the director is Dr. Caligari. I just wish that...
You'd have preferred more evidence to be doled out throughout the narrative.
Yeah, I know that's hard. I know it's, like, a mystery, I feel like, is one of the hardest things to write. I don't know if that's actually true, but I feel, when I think about trying to create a mystery and trying to dole out information at correct points in the story to keep people interested, I think that's really hard, and So I have empathy, but I do feel like it would be better if they were able to try and explain what's going on in the story in a slightly better way than just dumping it all on us in one diary reading scene. Even though it did lead to the best scene in the movie.
Yes. This scene is so iconic that it was part of the advertising campaign. The director of the asylum, having read the details of the mass killings in 1783 using a somnambulist, and he's contemplating doing it himself now that he's found one. And he steps outside, and the message, "You must become Dr. Caligari. Du musst Caligari werden," just appears in front of him.
Yeah.
And as he waves it away to shoo it off.
Yeah.
And then it appears from behind him, then above him, then around him, through him, everywhere. It starts popping up like a typewriter at the top edge of the screen. It's like it's the top of a page, just everywhere. It's in a film which is already very surreal looking, which is all the more impressive because the film's camera work is very, very, very flat. There are mid-range shots and there are close-ups. That is it. It's entirely conveyed through set structure and the fake lighting of the set, as well as just the blocking on the stage. Not the most minimalist, because that's obvious. That, I mean, if we've ever seen like Lars von Trier's Dogville, that is a stage. It's shot on a stage where each room is marked, written on the floor what room it is. An attempt at conveying a period piece through minimalism, because it's Lars von Trier.
Yeah.
Where was I going? I was just talking about the surreal look.
Yeah.
And that this really, really captures that even, and accentuates and really, really enhances the feel, just these spectral letters conveying the message. It's beautiful.
Yeah. And I like the fact that you can look at it in two different ways. Either it's just showing his descent into madness, or that there's some kind of almost us.
Yeah, there's a greater power which is compelling him.
Yeah. I feel like that one of the reasons that I'm already back to criticizing it, but I feel like one of the reasons why I went to supernatural sources is that just because it's like we don't know much about the director, and it's that thing where it's just so sudden, you know, just like he reads these like notes about how Dr. Caligari works and it just goes obsession and then he just becomes Dr. Caligari. It's one of those things where I get that it's old, but like with our own, like how we understand how stories are written and made now, it is a little bit sudden. Like it's just.
And this is always the difficulty of when you've spent a lifetime in seeing the modern end, the current end of film,
yeah.
And all the thing. Or when you're standing on the shoulders of giant, it's hard to see how low the ground is.
Yeah. And yeah, I don't want to criticize it too much because I say it is a really fun scene, and just visually, it's just so good to. To show whether it is supernatural or just him going crazy I don't think I've really seen that, anything quite like that in a live action kind of thing. It felt a lot like an anime or like one of those really creepy kind of ones, like say like an Evangelion or something like that, or it like just that kind of fourth wall kind of breaking that I don't think I see very much in live action too much.
Yeah, I mean that's part, it was a key component of expressionism.
And I kind of wish I'd
to see it more.
I'd like to see it tried, see like a modern take on something.
Yeah, like even when part of the members of the Expressionist movement moved into, a lot of them wound up working for Universal, and it's why all their early monster movies tend to have a similar look to this era of film.
Okay.
But not quite to the level of Doom was Caligari Verden.
I guess the problem is that it could very easily come across as hokey. And it kind of even does here. Like, it's not perfect, but it's just so
the rest of the film's aesthetic works, and you're already hooked onto that sort of vibe.
Yeah.
But when it does happen, it's just, I'm down for this right now.
Yeah. And especially because I never would have thought, when I think of old movies, old classic kind of movies, I'd never think of breaking the fourth wall in that kind of a way. Mm. And so that's why it just felt so sudden to me. I think that's why I liked it. It's not just like it, because I never would have predicted it. And it's a shame, I guess.
I think another good comparison would possibly be, not, it doesn't use text, but the escape scene in Brazil. if you've ever seen Brazil.
I have seen Brazil, yes.
I love that film. I'm fortunate to talk about Terry Gilliam these days, but yeah, Brazil is very good. And the way that the escape sequence begins and how it ends as well have the same sort of disconcerting expressionist vibe to them.
Yeah. And it also has like kind of descent into just madness. Of course, in that way, it's like in Dr. Caligari, it's a descent of one man into madness. And that in Brazil, it's like the movie, the world, and the character is just everything. It's just descending into farce and just madness. Like I want to use a better word than farce because it's a creepy kind of farce. Like farce is usually considered a comedy thing. This is like really disconcerting. Yeah, yeah. It's good to bring up Brazil because I like that movie as well. Yeah,
might have to make some top 10 films one day. All right, I think that'll just about cover us for tonight.
Yeah, I actually, especially after...
Did you like, all in all, would you recommend your experience with the Cabinet of Dr. Caligari?
I will admit there were some slower parts, and it was difficult to stay completely engaged with the film. I'd recommend it over Snow White. I'd recommend it over Book of Henry. I'd recommend it over most of the films that we've watched.
Over the Book of Henry.
Okay, no, I wouldn't. Actually, no, I wouldn't, because that movie needs to be seen by everyone.
Yes.
Even though I think, obviously, Dr. Caligari is a better made film than Book of Henry. I guess I would say if you're at all interested in... I can definitely see
if you're interested
why...
in film and you haven't done a film studies course for some reason, then you should check this out.
Yeah.
If you're doing a film studies course, this will probably pop up in your first year.
Yeah. And I can see why. Yeah. So I'd probably... sure. I would recommend it. Thumbs up.
Well then, thank you for listening. Next week, Jason X and Halloween.
Goodbye.